There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise.
There's a day that's drawing near when this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is
no more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will.
Hi, I'm Pastor Scott, and I want to read to you from John chapter 14, verses 1 through 6. Jesus is speaking there, and he says, "Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? So Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Many years ago, I heard Reverend Fred Luter speaking on this text, and he called it a promised place of peace. And in this Passion Week, this day of Palm Sunday, I was studying this, and this is something that Jesus says to his disciples during that week, during their time together before his betrayal, just comforting them and setting their minds and their hearts at ease on what is to come, the eternal home of the believer, the promised place of peace. There are three things very quickly I want to tell you about heaven, about this place that we long for, we look for, we hope for. The very first thing I want to tell you about heaven is that it is a promised place. The Bible is very clear about this. Jesus says, in my Father's house, there are many rooms. You may have heard it said, or you may have sung it like this, that there are many mansions. Either way, here's the point, is that there is a promised life after this, a promised place after this. He says, if it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? Jesus saying that he's not a liar. There is a promise after this. The Bible describes heaven many glorious ways. Describes as a place with crystal seas, pearly gates, streets of gold. And all of that is just symbolic pictures trying to show us the nature of the worth, of the worthwhile nature of heaven. But you see, all of the gospel writers and all of the biblical writers grasp, trying to come up with imagery to describe the beauty of what they've been able to see in visions given to them and prophecies given to them of what our eternal home is like. But here's what we know for sure, is that it will be a place with no shame, a place with no pain, no sorrow, because it's a place with no more sin, no more curse, no more death. But even more than that, what's promised about it is who will be there. Jesus, face to face with our Savior, with our Creator, with our Master, our Lord, our King. It's a promised place, and it's promised that He will be there. So heaven is a sure truth, a guaranteed hope, a promise of eternal life, our forever home with Christ. Not only is heaven a promised place, but heaven is a prepared place. It's what he says. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will, most definitely saying, I will come again and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. Heaven is a prepared place. Now, when Jesus speaks like this, you and I could easily miss it, but the disciples would have understood the imagery of what he's saying. In Jewish culture, this was wedding imagery. That when a couple was betrothed, when they were courting, when they were entering into the engagement time, that the bridegroom would leave and he would go to prepare the marriage home, most often adding a large room onto his family's home. And it's what Jesus is saying, that in my Father's house, there's many rooms. There's much room. And he's going to add on more room, preparing room for us in his Father's home, in his family. He goes to prepare this place. When the bridegroom would finish preparing the place, he would return and joyfully, gladly come and receive his bride. And then the betrothed would become married and they would go into this home together to begin their life. So he's saying to us, the church, the people of God, the redeemed, the body of Christ, the bride of Christ, the Bible calls us. If I go and prepare a place for you, he's saying you can know that I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. Heaven is absolutely a promised place. Heaven is likewise a prepared place. It is a place that God has prepared, is preparing for all the redeemed, all the born again, all those who have named Christ Jesus as Lord. It is a prepared place. But finally this morning, and most importantly, I want to tell you that heaven is not just a promised place that we can look forward to, a sure guarantee. It's not just a prepared place that has painstakingly, lovingly been prepared, but it is a prepared place for a prepared people. Heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. You see, not just anybody's going to heaven. Not everybody is going to heaven. But only those who are prepared, only those who are ready. It reminds me of a story of two guys who, they loved baseball. And they, maybe like many of you, they loved baseball. All they ever talked about was baseball. If they weren't playing it, they were watching it. They were talking about it. They were waiting to watch it. They loved baseball. And they got talking one day and they said, "Man, baseball is so good. Do you think there's baseball in heaven?" To which the other one replied, "You know, I don't know." And they got to talking about this and arguing this out. And they said finally, "You know what? Let's make a deal. Whichever one of us dies first, we'll come back and let the other one know whether or not there's baseball in heaven." Of course, this is not a true story. That's not the way things work. But for the sake of the argument, this happened. One of them died. And sure enough, he came back and he visited his friends, just like Christmas Carol by Dickinson. He came back and he visits his friend and he says, "Man, wow, you know, you're back. Tell me, what's heaven like?" He said, "Oh, heaven is the best." He said, "Wow, that's great. Man, you know, crystal sea, pearly gates, all that. Yeah, yeah." And the friend goes, "Oh, man, that's wonderful news. Hey, tell me, is there baseball in heaven?" To which the friend replies, "Well, that's what I came to talk about." He says, "Oh, no, tell me there's not baseball." He goes, "Oh, no, no, there is baseball." He goes, "Oh, that's good news." He says, "So what's the deal?" He goes, "Well, there is baseball in heaven, but you're pitching tonight." You see, the point is, my friends, that heaven's a prepared place for a prepared people. Everybody wants to go to heaven, but not everybody's ready. Many times we think of salvation like a ticket we purchase, and I've heard people describe it like that, and I don't like the imagery of that, because salvation is not just about where we're going, but it's about whose we are today. It's about eternal life today in Christ. But let's understand it like that for now, that we're not always all ready for heaven. Many of us are living for this life. We're living for this moment. We're living for now, for here. And my friends, if that's the case, if that's you, you're missing the point of life. It's not merely about the here and now. It's not merely about living our best life today or getting all we can today. My friends, it's about our forever home that we're longing for. And in this life, we're strangers, we're sojourners, we're exiles. Heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. So here's the question that you must be asking. How do I become a prepared person? I mean, if I was going on a trip, I'd prepare by making sure I have my passport, making sure my bags are packed, making sure I have all the itinerary ready, making sure everything's ready. How do I get prepared for my eternal trip, for my forever trip? I prepare by receiving Christ Jesus as Lord. That's it. It's not by making sure that I've got enough religion, not by making sure I've given enough money, not by making sure I've gone to enough churches, done enough things, my friends. These are all good things we do because we're saved, but not one of these things make us saved. What we do to prepare ourselves for our prepared, promised place of rest is that we come to a point in our life we recognize that we are sinners and we are in desperate need of forgiveness from God. That I have broken God's law, I have broken God's heart, and God's word clearly tells us over and over and over again that the soul that sins must die, that God is a just God who absolutely will punish sin with death and a spiritual death forever separated from Him in a place called hell. And my friends, it doesn't have to be this way. Because God, even though He is a just God who will punish sin, He is a loving God who sent His only begotten Son who died on the cross bearing that punishment for sin, for me, for you, and for all who will freely choose to trust in Him. Repenting of sin means turning from that way and turning to Him. How do I become a prepared person for this prepared, promised place? My friends, I received Christ Jesus as Lord. I cried out to Him over 20 years ago myself and said, Lord, I know that I'm a sinner. Nothing could have been more obvious in my life than I was a sinner and I was an enemy of God. So Lord, I recognize You died for me, even me. You were buried, You rose again. So Lord, won't You forgive of my sins? Save me and give me new life in You. And I won't lie to you telling you that I've gotten it all right ever since then, or that I've been perfect since then. So far from it. But I can tell you that God's always been faithful. And I can tell you that He saved me right then, forgave every sin I ever committed, everything I ever would do. In that moment, He made me a new creature. And if He can do it for me, He'll do it for you. So right where you are this morning, my prayer, my hope is that on this Palm Sunday, just as Jesus entered into Jerusalem triumphantly, you too will allow Him to enter into your heart as Savior, as Lord, as Master, that you would be saved and you would receive the promise of this prepared place as a prepared person, understanding that Jesus is Lord. My friends, He is, and I pray you know Him today. Let me pray for you. Lord God, I pray for each one seeing this and hearing this, the Lord God, that right now in this moment, they would know that they know that they know that they are a believer in Christ, a follower of Jesus, not on the basis of what they could do or have done or might do, but on what You absolutely did, Your finished work on the cross. So they're trusting in that, and that is their hope. That is their life. That is their love, Lord God. So Lord, I pray that they would know You as Lord. If they don't already, that right now they would cry out to You for forgiveness, for mercy, for grace, and surrendering their life to You as indeed a good, good Master, a great King, a loving Father. Lord God, save, deliver, heal, and bless us, Lord, to be able to know You and make You known. In Jesus' name, amen. Bless you, my friends.